Well, what a privilege it is for me to be here with you at Founders Week this week, and especially to have the privilege of being here on Alumni Day. Daryl, I was resonating with you a moment ago as you expressed your surprise at being in this position. In fact, just yesterday, my wife asked me, she said, "Did you ever imagine when you were sitting here as a student that someday you'd be speaking at Founders Week?" And the very simple answer to that question was no. In fact, I don't think anyone who was around me at that point was imagining that I was going to be speaking at Founders Week. I do feel a very great gratitude to Moody Bible Institute. I spent 3 years here back in the late 70s, and I'll tell you what I remember. I remember seeing God and His Word treasured by faculty members and by staff, by administrators and by fellow students, and that had a profound impact on my life. God gave me an excellent roommate, a friend who loved Jesus with all his heart. We became very close, and we remain dear friends to this very day. I'm so grateful for what God did in my life through all of these associations. And Beverly's life was shaped very dramatically by this place as well. Her father, Omar Brubaker, taught here for well over 30 years. She was a student here as well. We actually missed each other in our student days just by a year, which I think was probably a good thing. I suspect that Bev would have been just the opposite of attracted to me at that time, but God is very kind, and we connected several years later, but both of our lives were just profoundly shaped by our years here. And so I feel a debt of gratitude, and therefore I feel a great sense of privilege in standing here this evening. And I want to say I am so grateful to God for the momentum and the ballast that God has built into this institution for now well over 100 years. I believe that will serve Moody greatly in these days. And I find myself just particularly thankful for God's promises of protection and care to all who look to Him, which I believe those who are in leadership right now are doing. And so I find myself trusting God and very grateful to God. I have the privilege this evening of contributing to this theme of one new people, taken, as you know, from that great passage in Ephesians chapter 2, where we are told that Jesus died to bring into being, to create for Himself a new unified people. I tell you, we need this truth. The whole body of Christ needs this truth, and we need to hear it again and again. At the very heart of God's plan of salvation is a people, a great gathering of men and women from every time and from every place. God's purposes are not focused on many unrelated individuals, but on a new unified people. It is a central and major refrain throughout the entirety of Scripture. I will be your God, and you will be my people. And God's purposes are not only to redeem a people for Himself, but also to reconcile them with one another. This is, and it will be, one of the greatest displays of God's glory as diverse individuals and diverse groups of individuals are brought together into a real and a deep and an eternal unity. And that last thing, is my subject for this evening. My desire is for us to consider together God's ultimate goal, God's ultimate plan, God's ultimate destination for this new people that He has formed. I want us this evening to look together at a vision of the ultimate destiny of His then fully redeemed people, perfectly united together, and that is the vision of Revelation 21 and 22. So would you please turn there in your Bibles with me. The final chapters, not just of the book of Revelation, but of the entire biblical trajectory, Revelation 21 and 22. And as you probably know, the book of Revelation is it's a book of visions. Right from the beginning, we see that the Apostle John is instructed, write down what you see. And God proceeds to show him vision after vision all the way through this book. In fact, John repeatedly uses this little phrase, then I saw, then I saw, then I saw, all through this revelation which God gave him. And here at the very end, in Revelation chapters 21 and 22, God gives to John one last vision, this great and glorious vision of the church now finally and fully redeemed. It is a vision of God's people, God's one new people gathered now all together and home at last. Now, there is a part of me that just wants to read through this slowly and let it have its effect and then go sit down. But I've been called to teach, and so I'm going to do my best to do that, but I'm still going to read this slowly and carefully. And I ask you to pay very close attention. Everything here, everything, is meant to make an impression on us. So let your biblically informed imaginations be very active as I read Revelation 21, verse 1 through chapter 22, verse 5. This is God's word. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain any more, for the former things have passed away. And he who was seated on the throne said, behold, I am making all things new. Also he said, write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. And he said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give from the spring of the water of life without payment. The one who conquers will have this heritage, and I will be his God, and he will be my son. But as for the cowardly, the faithless, the detestable, as for murderers, the sexually immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars, their portion will be in the lake that burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death. Then came one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls full of the seven last plagues and spoke to me, saying, come, I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb. And he carried me away in the spirit to a great high mountain and showed me the holy city, Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, having the glory of God, its radiance like a most rare jewel, like a jasper, clear as crystal. It had a great high wall with 12 gates, and at the gates 12 angels, and on the gates the names of the 12 tribes of the sons of Israel were inscribed. On the east 3 gates, on the north 3 gates, on the south 3 gates, and on the west 3 gates, and the wall of the city had 12 foundations, and on them were the 12 names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. And the one who spoke with me had a measuring rod of gold to measure the city and its gates and its walls. The city lies 4 square, its length the same as its width, and he measured the city with his rod 12,000 stadia. Its length and width and height are equal. He also measured its wall 144 cubits by human measurement, which is also an angel's measurement. The wall was built of jasper, while the city was pure gold, clear as glass. The foundations of the wall of the city were adorned with every kind of jewel. The first was jasper, the second sapphire, the third agate, the fourth emerald, the fifth onyx, the sixth carnelian, the seventh chrysolite, the eighth beryl, the ninth topaz, the tenth chrysoprase, the 11th jacinth, the 12th amethyst. And the 12 gates were 12 pearls, each of the gates made of a single pearl. And the street of the city was pure gold, transparent as glass. And I saw no temple in the city, for its temple is the Lord God, the Almighty, and the Lamb. And the city has no need of sun or moon to shine on it, for the glory of God gives it light, and its lamp is the Lamb. By its light will the nations walk, and the kings of the earth will bring their glory into it, and its gates will never be shut by day, and there will be no night there. They will bring into it the glory and the honor of the nations, but nothing unclean will ever enter it, nor anyone who does what is detestable or false, but only those who are written in the Lamb's book of life. And then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, bright as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb through the middle of the street of the city. Also on either side of the river, the tree of life with its 12 kinds of fruit, yielding its fruit each month. The leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. No longer will there be anything accursed, but the throne of God and of the Lamb will be in it, and his servants will worship him. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads, and night will be no more. They will need no light of lamp or sun, for the Lord God will be their light, and they will reign forever and ever. Father, thank you so much for this book that you have given to us. We thank you that you've not left us just adrift on some sea of uncertainty. You have spoken. Yes, the secret things belong to God, but that which has been revealed belongs to us and to our children. And so, God, we pray, help us to listen and receive, and then use your word, we pray, to put faith and courage and hope in our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, let me begin this evening by asking you a question. It's a fairly simple question, nothing terribly profound or philosophical. Here it is. What are you looking forward to? Just think about that for a moment. What are some things that you are actually right now looking forward to? That's a question that I ask myself, not infrequently, and occasionally I'll ask others that question. I think it's a great question to kind of get a sense for where someone's at. So, what are you looking forward to? And while we're at it, let's just think for a moment. What does it actually mean to look forward to something? Well, when you look forward to something, it occupies your thoughts. You think about it. But more than that, there's a desire. There's a longing for the thing to come. And even more than that, there's typically some kind of getting ready for it, some emotional kind of psychological orientation of your mind and your heart toward that thing. Well, here's the thing this evening. I believe God wants his people actively looking forward to what he describes for us here in Revelation 21 and 22. I believe that's why he had John write this in a book, so that his people could have this in their minds and in their hearts and look forward to it. I mean, really, it's pretty clear that God wants those who are his to look forward to this future with great longing and with great hope. You know that company that started the whole stand-up paddleboard craze a few years ago? It's called YOLO, Y-O-L-O, which stands for You Only Live Once. That really bugs me. I mean, think about this. You only live once, and life is short, so make sure to go paddleboarding. Make sure to climb some mountain. Make sure to do this or that. before you die, I've actually suggested to my children that we should start up an alternative paddleboard company and name it YALT. Not Y-O-L-O, but Y-A-L-T, which stands for You Actually Live Twice. One short life, 70 or 80 years or so, and then a really long life called eternity. And God says to his people, keep that eternity in your mind. Look forward to that. God is saying to us, here is what's coming. Here is what you, as my people, can and should look forward to. This is where it's all heading. And so tonight, I just want to name and then describe five things that I see here in this vision of what God has for his people. Five things that God is setting before us here for us to see, so that we will look forward to them. I have two F's, a C, a D, and then another F, which sounds like a horrible report card. But here, it's all good news for God's people. In fact, it's amazing news, it's wonderful news. So first, number one, I see fulfillment here. We should be eagerly looking forward to, in fact, God wants us to be eagerly looking forward to the fulfillment of all that has been promised. We see that in some very specific ways throughout these chapters, but look with me again, especially at those opening verses. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. And death shall be no more, neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. And he who was seated on the throne said, behold, I am making all things new. You know, things got off to a wonderful start back in the beginning. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and everything was beautiful. I mean, rivers and trees and mountains and all sorts of living things on land and in the sea and in the air. David says it so eloquently in Psalm 104, how manifold are thy works, O Lord. In wisdom you have made them all. And then God made man, a man and a woman, and he put them there on the earth, the heavens above them, and he said, look, I made this for you. This is for you. And it was perfect. Things were very good. But then, as we know, something terrible happened. Adam and Eve rebelled against God. And in response, to show the magnitude of that rebellion, God subjected all of creation to futility, in which it remains. But God has promised something. From the time that the first heaven and the first earth were put under his curse, he has promised a new heaven and a new earth. Listen to how he said it through the prophet Isaiah many, many centuries ago. Just listen. This is Isaiah chapter 65. For behold, I create new heavens and a new earth. And the former things shall not be remembered or come into mind, but be glad and rejoice forever in that which I create. For behold, I create Jerusalem to be a joy and her people to be a gladness. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and be glad in my people. No more shall be heard in it the sound of weeping and the cry of distress. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And in the end, which will be a whole new beginning, God will make a new heaven and a new earth. We need to see the obvious and intentional parallel between Genesis 1:1, in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth, and Revelation 21:1, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. So get this, he's promised a new heaven and a new earth. And he's promised a new Jerusalem, a community of his people who will dwell in joy and in righteousness. And he's promised to dwell among his people. And he's promised to remove all weeping and all distress. And he's promised to protect his people and to present them to himself as a lovely and spotless bride. And all of these things come to fulfillment here in this time that is described in Revelation 21. Ultimately, God wants us to look forward to his promise to make everything new. That's what he says in verse 5. Behold, I am making all things new. Notice he does not say, I am making all new things. No, I am making all things new. There will be this fulfillment. So heaven, this future that we look forward to, is not some entirely different reality, some otherworldly, kind of ethereal, floating foreign existence. Listen to this. I read this on a Starbucks cup, of all places, several years ago. For a while, Starbucks was kind of doing this thing called The Way I See It, where people could voice their opinion about something, and Starbucks would put it on their cup. This one is from a guy named Joel Stein, who is a columnist for the Los Angeles Times. Here's what he said. Heaven is totally overrated. It seems boring to me. Clouds, listening to people play the harp. It should be something you can't wait to go to, like a luxury hotel. Maybe blue skies and soft music were enough to keep people in line in the 17th century, but heaven has to step it up a bit. They're basically getting by because they only have to be better than hell. You know, you hear sometimes people say, I don't particularly want to spend eternity sitting on a cloud playing a harp. Well, you know what? I don't either. And I don't know whoever said we were going to. I mean, what a goofy view of heaven. And I don't mean to be unkind, but somebody needs to tell Mr. Stein to read his Bible. Because when you read Revelation 21 and 22, you get a very different picture. It's a new heaven and a new earth, like the old one, only made completely new, just as God promised. You know, we have never experienced this universe, this life, the way God first made it. We can still see some reflection, some vestiges of glory when you look up at the night sky, or when you see a full display of autumn colors on a brilliant hillside against a beautiful blue sky. We can get a hint, but nothing, nothing like it will be when it's all made new. All that we can see and experience now, even at its very best, it just won't hold a candle to what's coming. He will make everything new. But let's not miss this. This description throughout this chapter is not just newness, like some marketing strategy, you know, new and improved. It's fulfillment. Every major strand of biblical promise is brought to fulfillment here. Covenant, fulfilled. Atonement, fulfilled. Temple, fulfilled. Kingdom, fulfilled. Marriage, fulfilled. Heaven and earth, fulfilled. God is bringing everything to the complete and perfect fulfillment he always intended. Oh, how we should look forward to this. And God wants us to look forward to it. This is what he has for his redeemed new people. Second, number two, there is freedom here. We should eagerly look forward to, God wants us to be eagerly looking forward to freedom from sin, from the curse, and all of their effects. Listen to how Paul speaks with such pathos about this. This is from Romans chapter 8. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to decay and obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation has been groaning together in the pains of childbirth until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit, we groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. Listen, none of us has ever experienced the true freedom that God intended us to live in. Never. We live under the curse, clouded by sin. The greatest frustration for Christians living in this world is not living in a world where everything is broken. As frustrating as that is, it's that we still sin. And we carry sin with us. We want to be holy, right? And we fall short every day. We want to be patient. We want to be kind with those around us, and we still say unkind and hurtful things. We want to worship God with all of our hearts, and we so often feel cold and dull. We want to live in peace and freedom, but we worry and we fear. We don't want to be at peace and harmony with other believers, but there are divisions and hurts and heartaches. We want to be actually righteous, but we still sin. I mean, I regularly wonder, don't you? What will it be like when sin is completely removed? I wonder how much of my life experience has been affected by the presence of sin in my life and in the world. We don't know. We've never experienced it. We don't even know what we don't know. Remember those Claritin commercials on TV? I mean, the commercial starts out, you're looking through this kind of hazy lens, and then you take Claritin, and this layer is peeled off, and you discover what you didn't realize you'd been missing all along. Well, it's the pre-Claritin experience that we're living in right now. Now we see through a glass darkly, and we just have no idea the profundity of the difference it will make to have the haze and the distraction of sin removed, gone. What will it be like to be really free like that? You see, it's not just that you'll be victorious over sin all the time in heaven. We won't even have to deal with sin. It won't even be present. I mean, just imagine for a moment with me a young tree on a windswept North Dakota hillside. Its whole life, it's had to do battle every day. The wind is always blowing incessantly. The tree spends its entire life having to fight this ever-present reality. Never, not even a moment of rest. Imagine what it would be like for that tree if all of a sudden the wind is just taken away. No more wind ever again, just air and stillness, sunlight. What a different experience. Friends, there will be for us a whole new experience that we've never had before. Our entire world will be changed. No longer any effect of sin on my conscience or on my consciousness. All of that just gone. No more division and disruption in our relating to one another as God's people. And none of the outward effects of sin and the curse. Look at chapter 21, verse 4. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. And death shall be no more, neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. And look at chapter 22, verse 3. No longer will there be anything accursed. Instead, look at verses 1 and 2 of chapter 22. Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, bright as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb, and through the middle of the street of the city, also on either side of the river, the tree of life with its 12 kinds of fruit, yielding its fruit each month. The leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. Now, I don't know for sure, but it sure seems like that is saying that the eternal life that God gives his people is perpetually sustained, and he will eternally cure every former sin. For the first time, God's perfect, newly renewed creation will be met by your full and unclouded capacity to experience life in that creation. And I'm guessing that you and I will be left utterly speechless at the experience. Friends, we just don't have any idea what this will be like, but clearly God wants us to look forward to it. To the day when our shame and our sinning will be a thing of the past, and all of the outward effects in the world will be a thing of the past, and we will stand in a new freedom of perfect righteousness. Oh, how we should look forward to that. And God wants his people to look forward to it. That's why this is here. Third, number three, community, perfect community. God wants us to be eagerly looking forward to that. Look with me at verses 9 and 10 of chapter 21. Then came one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls full of the seven last plagues and spoke to me, saying, come, I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb. And he carried me away in the spirit to a great high mountain and showed me the holy city, Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven. So John is, he's carried away in the spirit. He's brought to this high lookout point, this great high mountain, and he is shown this amazing city coming down from heaven. Remember that passage I quoted just a moment ago from Isaiah? Listen to verse 18 again. But be glad and rejoice forever in that which I create, for behold, I create Jerusalem to be a joy and her people to be a gladness. The reality of a glad community of God's people is represented here in Revelation 21 and 22 by this city, this new Jerusalem. Look at verse 2. Chapter 21, I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. That's just a little preview of the same vision John sees in verses 9 and 10. And all of that just elaborate description later in chapter 21. My goodness, you can get distracted by these measurements and this description of the foundations and all of those just spectacular jewels of every color of the rainbow and those pearly gates. All of that is there on purpose to communicate the splendor and the majesty of the city. But the main thing that that city represents is the community of God's people. That's the thing. Look at verse 3. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. It's the people. Just the buildings of that city, as elaborate as they might be, they don't have any purpose apart from the inhabitants who live there. Listen, every image of heaven that we see in the book of Revelation is a picture of a great gathering of people, God's redeemed community. We see that powerfully in chapter 5. We see it powerfully in chapter 7, a vast multitude from every tribe and every tongue and every nation, and they're living together in perfect community. They're not just getting along with each other. They're dwelling together in this great city in deep and happy and rich community with lots of joy and lots of happiness to a degree that we have never experienced before. You know, the great theologian Augustine once said, all of us who will enjoy God in heaven will also at the same time be greatly enjoying one another. Isn't that good? All of us who will enjoy God in heaven will also at the same time be greatly enjoying each other. Friends, this city here in Revelation 21, in all of its glory, is designed to show us the breathtaking beauty, the magnitude of the community of God's redeemed people. You know, there's so many connections in these chapters back to Genesis 1 and 2. To that original paradise. You've got the tree of life. You've got this river flowing down through the middle of things. They're so clearly reminiscent of Eden. But there's one striking difference. It's no longer a garden just occupied by two people. It's now a great city occupied by a great multitude, all of God's people. From every beautiful culture and language, one people. Living together in joy, and in peace, and in prosperity, and in freedom, which is very unlike our experience in the world now. Oh, how we should look forward to this perfect, harmonious community. But even greater than that, even better than the experience of perfect human community, number 4, our dwelling with God. We will be with God. There's no question that we should, as his people, be eagerly looking forward to this. God wants us to be looking forward to this dwelling with him. You know, the Bible often uses the illustration of marriage to describe God's relationship with his people. But think about this. Here is God stuck in the longest bad marriage in history. And yet, it all ends with this marvelous new wedding, with his bride beautiful before him. Verse 2, I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And look again at verse 3. I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. This incredible reality of God dwelling as a husband among his people with them. This is the central and primary reality of the new heaven and the new earth, to be with God, to see him, to recognize him, to know him, to live with him. This is what we were made for, to be in close relationship with him. We may think we want 100 different things, but being with God is what we were made for. This is heaven's chief and irresistible attraction. And God's presence, did you notice this as we read before? God's presence will affect everything else. Look at verse 10. And he carried me away in the spirit to a great high mountain and showed me the holy city, Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, having the glory of God. And look at verse 23. And the city has no need of sun or moon to shine on it, for the glory of God gives it light. Everything, everywhere will be charged with God's presence. Nothing you see or experience in heaven will ever be dull or drab or ordinary. All will be given a quality of glory to it. But it's in the opening verses of chapter 22 where this really comes out. Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, bright as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb through the middle of the street of the city. God will be a fountain of living water to his people, and we will be right there drawing on that source of life. And then verse 3, no longer will there be anything accursed, but the throne of God and of the Lamb will be in it, and his servants will worship him. But now look at verse 4. They will see his face. Can we just linger there a moment? I don't want to get sentimental here. I don't believe that is John's purpose. No, there is some great reality that he is communicating by that phrase, we shall see his face. That's not just some kind of casual sighting, you know, like I saw so-and-so at the grocery store today. No, we shall see his face without any restriction, no longer through a glass darkly. We'll recognize him whom we've never seen before. We'll know him. There will be indescribable joy in our hearts just being with him. Jesus said it when he was here on earth, this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, perfect communion, God dwelling with us and us with him, us being his being ours. It is the greatest longing of the human heart, and we will have it. Oh, how we as his people should look forward to that. Now fifth, number 5, foreverness. Fulfillment, freedom, perfect community, dwelling with God, all these we should look forward to, and this. Foreverness. We should be eagerly looking forward to. God wants us eagerly looking forward to foreverness. In other words, none of the things that we've been talking about will go away ever. Maybe you've heard of Edgar Allan Poe's poem called The Raven. Once upon a midnight dreary, while I pondered weak and weary. It's this kind of dark and strange poem about a man who's lamenting the loss of relationship with this woman, Lenore. And while he's sitting there in his room pondering, this raven flies into his window and perches up on the bookcase, and he just keeps repeating one word over and over. Remember? Nevermore. Nevermore. Which is Edgar Allan Poe's commenting with chilling brevity on the reality that every one of us lives with in this life. The passing of things, the the irreversibility of time. When things are gone, they're gone irretrievably. When your youth is gone, it's gone. When your loved ones die, they're gone. And the sadness that we experience in this life as a result of that is a powerful thing. I have a daughter who was a fine athlete in high school. She wasn't the most naturally gifted, but she gave herself with all her heart to her sport, and she became quite good. In her freshman year, she went out for cross country, and she did all right. But later that year, during her freshman track season, something very special happened. She had a breakout race. She won the two-mile race at a major event as a freshman, and both her coach and her dad wondered if maybe she had something special in her. And later that spring, she qualified for state as a freshman, and she was so thrilled, and I was so proud of her. She didn't have the best race at state, but she was there, and then in the off season, she worked really hard. And as her sophomore year began, she started winning a lot of races. And again, she qualified for state, both the mile and the 2 mile. She ran well. Her junior year, she qualified again for both. She ran really well. And all of this time, she's just really loving the whole experience. The team, the coaches, the sport. She'd made friends with runners from all over the state. I mean, she had entered fully into this. Now, I'm sharing this with you for a reason. I'm not just trying to relive those days. Maybe I am a little bit. Here's my point. After the state meet, her senior year, she'd had a great senior season. And she qualified again for the mile and the 2 miles. She ran her races, and after her last race, her very last race of her high school career, we're in this big field house. And we're needing to go to get her back home for her graduation. And Abby wanted to go over to her coaches and try somehow to communicate her gratitude for everything they'd done for her. And she lingered there a bit, and she just didn't want to leave. She knew what that moment represented. And as we finally turned to walk back across that field house, my daughter just began to weep. She wept like I had never seen her weep before. Something was passing and would soon be irretrievably gone. Something very precious to her and deeply a part of her life was gone, and it wasn't coming back. And there was nothing she could do to keep it, and it just broke her 17-year-old heart. I tried to comfort her. I tried as her dad, knowing there was nothing I could do. She was experiencing the heartbreaking reality of the passing of life, the nevermore of life. And the truth is, she'll experience that over and over again in this life, as will we all. But now, look at how this passage ends. Chapter 22, verse 5. They will need no light of lamp or sun, for the Lord God will be their light, and they will reign. Do you see those words? Forever and ever. They, God's people, all who are in Christ, will live like this, in this great fulfillment, in this incredible freedom, in this perfect community, in this completely satisfying dwelling with God forever and ever. You ever thought about that phrase, forever and ever? I mean, forever kind of gets it done all by itself, doesn't it? But the Bible likes to speak like this. And so do we. It's in our hearts. It shows up powerfully in our consciousness. And we try to get our little minds around it, but we can't. But it's in our hearts. He has set eternity in our hearts. And no matter what someone might try to do to squelch that, it's there. And for the awakened soul, for the believer in Jesus, it's a longing for something that we can and should look forward to, and God wants us to. That's why he had John write this down, so we could see it and look forward to it. You know, sometimes here on earth, in the midst of a happy time, we can find ourselves saying or thinking, you know, I wish this would never end, but it always does. But when we get home, when we all get to heaven, we will say this, this is it. I want this to last forever. And it will. Well, let me wrap this up tonight by one more focusing question. Who is this revelation for? Who does God have in his mind when he tells John to write this down? Here's the answer. All the redeemed people of God. All of those who by trusting in Jesus have been ransomed. In other words, the church, God's one new people. This is for us. All those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Did you see those words there at the end of chapter 21? Only those who are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. So this is for you. If your name is written in that book, this is for us, the people of God, the bride of Christ, the redeemed of the Lamb, God's one new people, all whose names are written in a book. I read recently William Faulkner's great novel, The Sound and the Fury. It's one of those novels that's been sitting on my shelf for a long time. I finally pulled it down off the shelf and read it. It's the story of the economic and moral and spiritual decline of the South in the early 20th century. It's a very challenging novel to read just on a literary standpoint, but if you hang in there, you'll soon meet Dilsey. Dilsey, the elderly African-American woman who is a house servant of the degenerate and unraveling Compton family, and she, Dilsey, is the only point of moral sanity and spiritual life in the story. And at one point, the Compton family is planning to change the name of one of their children because of some potential embarrassment, and into that discussion, Dilsey speaks, and here's what she says. Changing his name ain't going to help him. Folks don't have no luck changing names. My name been Dilsey since before I could remember, and it'll be Dilsey when people's long forgot me. How will it be Dilsey when she's long forgot, Caddy asked. It'll be in the book, honey, Dilsey said, writ out. Can you read it, Caddy said. Won't have to, said Dilsey. They'll read it for me. All I got to do is say, I's here. Listen to me, if your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, someday they'll read it. God will read it. And all of your longings, all you've looked forward to, will be brought wonderfully into being. And you will hear God say, welcome home. And you will say, with a heart full of wonder and amazement, I's here. I's here. But it won't just be you. You will not be alone. A vast multitude of people from every tribe and tongue, from every time and place, all God's people will say, we're here. Here at last. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Amen. Amen. Let's pray together now.